I'm going to talk about records and tuples, and I'm going to explain why this is an important proposal to the JavaScript language. So first, to introduce myself, I'm Sébastien Lorber. You can follow me on Twitter or read my blog post if you want. I've been a developer for maybe over 10 years and a React early adopter a few years ago. I've been a freelance for 4 years now, and last year, I had the opportunity to work for Facebook on Docusaurus, which is a documentation static site generator, which permits to easily deploy documentation online by just writing Markdown files. So today, I'm going to talk about records and tuples. It's a proposal to the ECMAScript language, which is somehow JavaScript. How does it work? It is a proposal that is from on the TC39 committee, which is the committee that is responsible to make evolutions to the JavaScript language. It is currently in stage two, which means it's already quite advanced. And people know about this proposal for being new immutable data structures that will be native to JavaScript. But I think the most important part of this proposal is not widely known. It's more about the compound primitives behavior, which has a lot more impact for me than just being immutable data structures. So tonight, I'd like to explain to you why I think this proposal is very important and what are the many advantages for JavaScript in general and in particular React. So to explain a bit how the JavaScript language evolved over time, there is the TC39 committee, which is part of ECMA International Working Group. So it's a group of persons responsible to discuss the evolution of JavaScript. And so there are proposals that are in multiple stages. So the first stage is the ID. You just have an informal ID that you submit to the committee, but you have to be a member of the committee to be able to submit such IDs, because otherwise it would be quite messy. The stage one is you have a formal proposal, which is not a specification, but is somehow an ID, but described in a more formal language with some API and examples. The stage two, you have a draft specification, which means that you now use a very formal language, which is quite hard to understand if you already read a specification from ECMAScript. You also have polyfills. You also have available Babel transforms that should be available. Somehow, from the stage two, you can start to play with the proposal in a sandbox or locally if you try to load polyfills and things like that. The stage three is more advanced. You already have a quite stable specification. You are waiting for the last feedbacks to the proposal to make last minute changes before it is a part of JavaScript. Also, TypeScript will start to implement the proposal at stage three. And also browser vendors tend to start implementing the features, and maybe Node.js if it's meaningful for Node.js and things like that. So it's not, we don't know exactly, I don't know exactly how the browser vendors choose to implement a feature or not, but generally at this stage, they start to think about it, and because the proposal is quite likely to end up in JavaScript. And so when it reached the stage four, the proposal is completed, and it will be in the next ECMAScript version. So today, I want to talk about records and tuples. Let's present what this is. Somehow, it's like regular objects and arrays. So you are already used to these structures in JavaScript. If you look at a record, you can see that it's quite similar to an object in JavaScript. You can create it, but it has hash syntax as a prefix. You can log it like an object. You can access an attribute like an object. You can update it in an immutable way like an object, but something different is that you can't reassign an attribute of this record because it is immutable. So the tuple is quite similar, but it's more like an immutable array. You can create an array with the hash syntax and it is now a tuple. You can log it to see the values of your tuple. You can access a value at a given index, but you can't reassign a value at a given index because it is immutable. And something interesting is that all the methods that are available on the array, like filter, sum, every, and things like that, are also available on the record. So somehow it's quite easy to intervert a record by an array and vice versa if you don't do any mutation on it. You can also update it in an immutable way by using the spread syntax to change the value at a given index or add or append or prepend a value to this tuple. So what you need to understand is that the hash syntax is just a shortcut. What you can do is also use the global record constructor or the additional methods like from entries or tuple.from, which permits to create records and tuples from a list of entries. You can also nest records and tuples in a deeply nested way. So you can create a record that contains tuples and records and recursively. So, but there is something that is forbidden. You can't put non-primitive types inside a record. So for example, if you try to put a regular object inside a record, you will have an exception that says that the object is not a primitive type, so you can't put it inside a record. It's the same for many types in JavaScript, like a date. It is not a primitive type, and it is actually mutable. A class is also not a primitive type, and a function is also not a primitive type. So what are the primitive types that you can put in a record? When I say record, I mean a record and tuples because it's a bit complicated to say this. What can you put inside a record? You can put all the primitive types like string, number, boolean, begin, symbol, undefined, null. And also you can put records and tuples inside each other because records and tuples are considered as compound primitives, so somehow they are primitives too. Now let's talk about the most important part of the proposal. It's about the identity of the records and tuples. So let's see how it compares to objects and arrays. If you have, for example, two object instances which have exactly the same content, you can try to use the triple equal operator to see if the two object instances are equal, and it will return false because these are two distinct instances. The two objects are different identities, and if you modify one, you don't modify the other, and vice versa. But if you use the triple equal operator for one attribute, like the value one, which is a primitive, the value one of the first object and the value one of the second object are equal because the primitive types are always equal when their value are equal. And in the same way, if you look at the B attribute, you can see that the array which contains three and are contain exactly the same for both objects, but again, the two arrays have different identities. So the triple equal operator will return false in this case too. Now let's see what's the behavior for record and tuples. This is very different from objects and arrays because if two records have exactly the same content, it's guaranteed that the triple equal operator will return true. The records and tuples are compound primitives because the primitive values, if they have the same value, they are always equal. And the records and tuples, if they have the same value, they are also always equal. So this is very important to understand because it has a lot of implications for, in particular, React. I will explain later with some demos so that you can understand what this means for React in particular. Now let's talk about the interoperability. Records and tuples are very interoperable with JSON because JSON only contains primitive values. It can contain arrays, it can contain strings, numbers, and things like that. So somehow, JSON object is an object which contains generally just primitives, but you can easily convert it to a record because all the values inside JSON are compatible with convertible to a record. And if you have an object or an array, it's not always compatible because, for example, your object may contain a function, but this is not the case for JSON because a JSON file can't contain a function. It can only contain strings and numbers and things like that. So even if you have nested objects and arrays inside the JSON object, they are easily convertible to a record or a tuple because you can use the from and from entries methods to do the conversion. So how do we update records and tuples? It's still, if you are used to immutable data structures, in particular in React, you know that it can be a bit complicated to update objects in an immutable way, particularly if you have nested attributes. You have to use a lot of spread syntax to spread the previous values and mutate the new attributes that you want to change. So with records and tuples, it's not going to be easier. You still have to use this syntax, and you will still need to use a library like maybe Lodash or Emerge.js. I don't know exactly how these libraries will support records and tuples when the time will come. But there is a child proposal to records and tuples, which will permit to use a new syntax that will be much more convenient to update the libraries in the records and tuples in a nested way. And I think it will remove the need for libraries like Emerge.js if you have ever used it. Even the creator, Michael Westrat, was quite happy to see this proposal because he thinks that it deprecates the library that he created. Now let's talk about the benefits of records and tuples for React. I think it has many benefits. I will just explain four of them. For example, the security, the behavior, the performance, and the API surface. So let's talk about the security. You know that when you use React, that it's not a good practice to mutate the props that you receive. Now, if you receive records as props, you can't mutate them. So if you try to, for example, if you receive a profile prop in your React component and you try to modify the name, you will not be able to do this because you will get an exception if you try to do that. So somehow it's already possible today if you use object freeze in a deeply nested way to have the same security. But I think it has a cost to use a library to do that. And it's better if it can be native to JavaScript. So this is an additional security that you get for free. Now, more importantly, some behavior impacts. So let's imagine that you have a React component like that. You are creating an API filters object from two other objects. One is user filter and the other is company filter. And you use this API filters object as a dependency in a React effect. So what will happen here? The thing is, every time this component renders, the API filters object is recreated, so it has a different identity each time it renders, and the use effect will have this API filters object in the dependency array, so the use effect will trigger the effect for each render, which will fetch the user and company data, which will then set the result in the component state. And then the component will render and the API filters will be recreated, which will re-trigger the use effect and it will create an infinite loop. So the thing is, if instead of using an object, you use a record here, you will not have this infinite loop because as long as the API filters has the same, contain exactly the same data, for example, the username is Sebastian, you will the use effect will not re-execute because the API filter's object identity will keep being the same. So the dependency array will be able to understand that it is not worth it to run the effect. So this, I think, here for such a use case, records and tuples are very interesting because it will solve a lot of bugs that that we have in React applications today, where the tend to re-execute not always when we want, because we have the objects and array identities that are constantly changing. And even libraries that were created by people like mcdots to prevent infinite loops in React applications to, for example, you can use deeply equal effect or something like that, which will compare the previous API filters with the next one with a deep equality check to see if the object contains the same data. There are a lot of solutions like this to try to solve this problem currently, but I think records and tuples is a very idiomatic solution to this problem to solve. You just have to use records and tuples whenever you can, and the problem is solved a lot of the time. So in the same way, you have potential performance benefits. It's quite similar to the use effect here. Imagine you get a user and a company, and you are trying to create a user and company object in your React component, and then you pass it as prop to another component which is memoized. So what you expect is that the user and company view component here is optimized with React memo, and you don't want it to remember. To render if the data has not changed. But the thing is, if you create a new user and company object identity every time the app render, the user and company view will not be able to optimize the rendering because it receives a new object user and company instance, which will trigger the re-render again and again. And you have a lot of wasted resources for that, that could be optimized if you just use a record. Because if you use a record here, the user and company object will have a much more stable identity, and the user and view company view will be able much more easily to optimize the rendering because it always receives the same object, and React memo is able to understand that and block the rendering. In a similar way, I think there are benefits for the API surface. It's not already decided what will be the syntax for TypeScript. This is just some syntax that I invented. There is no immutable record in TypeScript. Actually, there is a record already, so there is some kind of conflict because it's not sure how TypeScript will introduce records and tuples because there is already a record type which is not an immutable type. It's more like an object. With TypeScript, I think there are benefits because you will be able to tell React, for example, that your component only accepts immutable a record instead of a regular object. And somehow it is more explicit because now you will be able to use maybe hooks that really need to receive stable identities. It's very easy in React applications to have bugs where, for example, you create a hook and you know that the hook will only work if, for example, the parameters you pass to it are stable. So if you always pass new identities, maybe the hook will trigger weird things like unwanted side effects and things like that. Now you have the ability to use with TypeScript a more explicit API contract to say, hey, I'm creating an API here. I want you to provide me very stable identities. If the data doesn't change, don't pass me objects that are different because I expect you to provide me stable objects somehow. So this is a bit complicated to explain all that. So I'm going to show you two real world demos so that maybe you will understand better how records and tuples will solve such problems. So let's look at the demos. So this is a React application. I'm going to run it soon. So for now, I'm just showing the code. We are creating a list of user. You can see that there is the user list component here. it is just, it receives the users as props, and then it just loop over the users, and it will render the user list items here. You can see that all the components are memoized to optimize the rendering. Now let's see the application that I'm going to, maybe it's a bit too big because we don't see it as a whole. So the application that I'm going to run is going to fetch the list of users from a backend. Actually, it's from a fake API method because I don't have a backend for this demo, but let's think about calling a backend. We are going to have filters on the application. I will have, for example, the ability to filter by name and to filter by sex. And we are going to see the problem that I described about the infinite loop. So if we run this application, let's see what happens. You can see on this side that the application here is working, but you can see on the log, there is something happening. You can see there is an infinite loop. It keeps fetching the users again and again. So basically, if you use this in the real world, you are going to query your backend every second because there is the infinite loop in the use effect. So what happens here? The problem is that you have the list of users here, but the thing is, every time you refetch the users from the backend, what happens is that the backend is giving you a different object identity. So this is something that can be surprising, but every time you refetch the list of users, even if the list of users didn't actually change, when you deserialize the response from your backend, you always get a new object identity. So what I wanted to say is that here you can see that the filters is a composition of the name and the sex filter. So for example, here I have the name, I can type Sebastian, and it is able to filter, but you can see that it triggers an infinite loop. Now I can also filter by sex, it works. You can see that there are still this infinite loop problem. So now let's see why this problem happens. It's because the filters object here is always a new object that is different from the previous one. And the dependency array here is going to have this filters object because we need this filter to fetch the data from the backend. And it is going to create the infinite loop because it then sets the results, which then retrigger the render, which then recreates the filters object here. Now, if we just use the hash syntax in front of the object here, what you can see here is that it's the infinite loop has stopped to render. And now, for example, if I just change the filters here, I am able to call the backend with the new filters, and the backend is only called when the filters change and there is no infinite loop anymore. Now this is the demo. So there are implementation details that I don't show because it's not very important. It's more, I think the important part is this line in particular that permits to avoid this infinite loop. And I think it's quite common to actually create objects and pass them to dependency arrays by mistake, and it can lead to a lot of problems. If you are familiar with React, maybe you already saw these problems before. So now I'm going to present another demo. This demo, we have a user component that is optimized. We can see that there is React Memo here. So there is React Memo because we want to optimize the rendering. There is also a component on which we use React Memo because we want to optimize the rendering. And there is the user and company component, also optimized, which will use the user and company independent components to render. Now I have another application. What we will do is that we are going to fetch the data from the backend every second and set it to state, and then render the user and company. And we are going to track when the components re-render. So what you can see here is that I'm refetching the data from the backend every second, and the data doesn't change much. Only my age is incrementing every 5 seconds. But what you can see in this demo is that even if the data barely change, all the components constantly re-render because there is something wrong here. And the thing is, every time you call your backend API, it returns a new object. For example, if you have fetch the data from the backend and you call fetch response.json to get the JSON object back, it will give you a different object identity, even if it contains exactly the same data as it used to contain the previous call. You will get a new object identity, and this object will be set in the React state here. You will pass this object as a prop in this component. And despite the user and company, the user and the company component being all three optimized with React Memo, you will have all the components re-render because all the objects from the new backend response have actually different object identities. So this is quite something that happens quite often in real world applications, because for example, you might want to refresh the data when you navigate. You might say, for example, when the user click on the navbar, I want to refresh the user data because I want to be a bit pessimistic, and maybe his avatar has changed in another tab or whatever, or you want somehow to keep fresh data in your UI. And the thing is, you are, every time you refresh the data from the backend, you are going to waste a lot of resources because basically all your React application has to re-render because you receive a new payload and this payload is used in a lot of places. But the thing is, often you fetch, for example, you refresh the user data, but most of the time the user data didn't change. It's not very often that the username or the avatar will change, and you're rendering all the components in a useless way for when this happens. So how can we fix this? Actually, it's pretty simple. Instead of fetching an object from your backend, what you can do is fetch a record. So here I have just added a toggle so that I can fetch a record or an object if I change the value. So now instead of fetching an object, I'm going to fetch a record. And what you can see in this demo is that now the re-renders are much more less frequent. You can still see that the app is re-rendering every 5 seconds because actually the age of the user Sebastian is increasing every 5 seconds. And you can see that the intermediate components also re-render every 5 seconds, and the user component re-render only every 5 seconds instead of every second. And the company, which the data of the company never changes over time, you can see it never re-renders again, because actually as we converted the company to a record and the data of the company didn't change over time, the company component is able to optimize this rendering by understanding that the company prop didn't change. So this way, just converting objects to records when you fetch data from backend is able to optimize for free your React application, because you save a lot of free renders that you otherwise trigger unnecessarily. So actually there is no current method to fetch a record from your backend. You have to convert it. So I have added some kind of conversion logic here to convert manually the payload from the backend. But in practice, I think in the specification they will add a method like response.record so that you can directly obtain a record from your backend. But I'm not sure it's specified yet. So we'll see in the future if it becomes available. So this is all for the demo. I'd like to explain a bit the trade-offs. So JavaScript with records and tuples, some people think that JavaScript will become more complex. I mean, somehow people don't like the hash syntax because it will add a new syntax that people will have to learn. And it's becoming harder and harder to learn JavaScript, which is not anymore a toy language, but that people used to learn quite easily a few years ago. Also, there is a problem, for example, if you want to put a date in a record or any other non-primitive type, it's a bit complicated, but maybe you still want to do that. If you really want to do that, instead of putting the non-primitive type inside the record, you will have to put a reference of to the primitive type in the record, and then somehow cache the non-primitive type in a map somewhere else, like a bit like a database, so that you can reference the non-primitive type. But it's not very very straightforward currently, so I don't know if it will become a problem. The implementation details of the proposal are not specified, so this is just a language for now. Maybe we don't know exactly what are the performance impacts of using a record versus an object, so we will have to wait for browser vendors to propose implementation of this to see how performant it is, because maybe there will be a little performance overhead if you use a record instead of an object. Also, there is the problem about the existing record TypeScript type, because we don't know how this will be managed, because we can't have two types with the same name. So we will have to find maybe a new name for the JavaScript record. So to conclude, I think records and tuples are very easy to use, and immutability is one interesting part, but the most important one is really the compound primitive behavior, because it will solve a lot of use cases that we have in real world applications. I think I tried to explain some of the use cases in a React application here, but it also has potential impacts in other frameworks as well. I don't know much over frameworks, but for example, I know that Angular has there is something called change detection on push, which also leverage immutability. And I think records and tuples could be useful as well to optimize the performance of Angular applications. And also any other application that benefits from the immutable data structures and using object identities to optimize things and things like that. So that's all for me. Thank you for listening to my talk. And if you have questions, you can ask me on Twitter now or maybe email me. I have written a blog post about records and tuples for React on my site. So if you want to take a look, you will have maybe a few more use cases for React. Maybe you'll find this interesting. Thank you.